Recorded Books presents Accra Noir, edited by Nanama Danquah, narrated by Kofi Boachie, Anniwaa Boachie, and Nanama Danquah. Introduction. Cry your own cry. Accra is the perfect setting for noir fiction, the telling of such tales, ones involving or suggesting death, with a protagonist who is flawed or devious, driven by either a self-serving motive or one of the seven deadly sins, is woven into the fabric of the city's everyday life. Allow me to explain. Accra is a city that stands at the center of the world. Of course, this is technically untrue. The center of the world is at the meeting point of those two imaginary lines that divide the globe into hemispheres, separating north from south and east from west, the equator and the prime meridian. It's the intersection of 0 degrees latitude with 0 degrees longitude. Accra's geographic coordinates are latitude 5 degrees 33 minutes 21.6 seconds north and longitude 0 degrees 11 minutes 48.8 seconds west. Not quite the center of the world, but remarkably close. Those few degrees of distance notwithstanding, Accra has long served as the meeting point of East and West, North and South, as a cultural crossroads. Accra is one of the most well-known cities in Africa. It's the capital of Ghana, which in 1957 became the first sub-Saharan, read black, nation to gain independence from colonialism. But the city, in all its globalism, predates the nation. Prior to becoming a sovereign land, the area now known as Ghana was the Gold Coast, a British colony formed in 1867. 10 years later, Accra was installed as its capital. For nearly a century, in addition to being a political and financial center, the city was a major hub of trade. People came from Europe and other African nations to trade everything from gold and salt to guns and slaves. Accra is more than just a capital city. It is a microcosm of Ghana. It is a virtual map of the nation's soul, a complex geographical display of its indigenous presence, the colonial imposition, declarations of freedom followed by coups d'etat, decades of dictatorship, and then, finally, a steady march forward into a promising future. There is a story in every name, be it of a building or a neighborhood, such as Christiansborg Castle, Jamestown, Cantonments, Flagstaff House. Many roads and landmarks are dedicated to the architects of independence, not just Kwame Nkrumah, J.B. Danquah, William Oforiatta, Edward Akufo-Addo, Ebenezer Akwaje, and Emmanuel Obechebe Lamptey, the six men who are recognized as Ghana's founding fathers, but other leaders as well, including those of the non-aligned movement like Egypt's Gamal Abdel Nasser, India's Jawaharlal Nehru, and Yugoslavia's Josip Broz Tito. Given that Ghana's Independence Day is March 6, one might wonder why there is a street named 28th February Road, situated by Black Star Square and Independence Arch. It commemorates the Accra riots, which began on that date in 1948 and continued for 5 days in response to the deaths of three protesters, ex-servicemen, at the hands of the colonial police. The riots were considered a clarion call for freedom. It makes sense, then, that 28th February Road leads directly to the Monuments of Liberty. Inside Black Star Square, upon declaring Ghana a free nation, Dr. Kwame Nkrumah, the first president, issued another clarion call. Our independence is meaningless unless it is linked up with the total liberation of Africa. This is not intended to be a history lesson, though history is perhaps the most straightforward way to explain how multifaceted the city is, how everything in and about it holds meaning and is sending a message. When in Accra, one learns quickly to look beyond the literal. It is not enough to consider a text. One must also consider the context. Beware of a pretext. Search for a subtext. Earlier, I likened Accra to a map. As with most maps, there exists a legend through which one can decode any and all aspects of the place. Legends are merely definitions, commentaries. Accra is a city of storytellers, people who speak and live and love in parables and aphorisms and proverbs. Sprawled on the back windows of taxis and trotros, the minivans that are used for unregulated public transportation, are sayings such as, cry your own cry. Every day for thief, one day for master. Jealousy will kill you. Haste not in life, and so on. Admonitions and affirmations are also conveyed in symbols. The Ga people, an ethnic group that has inhabited Accra for over five centuries, have a system of symbols called Samai. An example is Adowafai, the name of a symbol that translates literally into English as deer's hat or crown. The message of this symbol is that the most admirable traits of the deer, such as its cunning, agility, wisdom, and swiftness, are also evident in a great ruler. The tribes of the Akan clan also utilize a similar system of symbols called Adinkra. An example is Sisawusuban, the symbol of transformation. The literal translation of the words is change your character. This symbol is actually made up of two other Adinkra symbols, the morning star, which represents the dawn of a new day, and the wheel, which represents rotation or independent movement. These symbols from both the Samai and Adinkra are ever present. They are used in the design of cloth, jewelry, and home decor. They are utilized in the creation of visual art and referenced in music and literature. They are an essential part of the culture that shapes life in Accra. The use of proverbs is not limited to the windows of vehicles and a set of symbols belonging to a specific tribe. Far from it. When an individual dies, a special cloth is designed for mourners to wear at the funeral. Each cloth design has a name, and each name is an aphorism. Weddings and naming ceremonies are rife with parables. Everything in the culture revolves around story, and every story has a moral or theme, one that can be encapsulated in a pithy phrase. We are born into this tradition. There is one name that every child in Accra who's able to walk and talk definitely knows, Kweku Anansi. He is the closest thing we have to a mascot or superhero. Anansi is a trickster, capable of assuming any form, though his usual appearance is half man, half spider. The stories of his adventures and misdeeds are called Anansisem, or spider stories. Before Kweku Anansi won the right to have all stories bear his name, those stories belonged to Nyankupong, the sun god, and were called Nyankonsem. There are many different tales about how and why Nyankonsem became Anansisem. The one I will share with you happens to be my favorite. Legend has it that Nyankoupon issued a challenge. He wanted to teach death, a taker, a lesson about loss. Anyone who could bring Nyankoupon the golden broom, golden pipe, and golden sandals that belonged to death would have all the stories renamed after them. Everybody wanted the stories, but they feared death. Whenever my grandmother would tell me this story, she would pause after this observation and say, "That's the way it is, Nanama. Everyone wants to go to heaven, but nobody wants to die to get there." Only Kweku Anansi, a slick and wily creature, was foolish enough to take Nyankoupon up on the challenge. With the help of a few other creatures whom he'd promised to feature in the stories once they became his, Anansi entered the kingdom of death, a place from which no one had ever managed to return. But Anansi did return, with the items he'd been challenged to retrieve. He also returned with death hot on his heels. Anansi had planned for this turn of events. He and the creatures who'd helped him enter the kingdom had even laid out a trap. Once they successfully captured death, they chopped it up into 1,000 tiny pieces, which they then scattered all across the land. That is why death now exists everywhere. Nyankoupon kept his word and turned the stories over to Anansi, making them Anansi-sem. The stories, particularly the ones that specifically feature Kweku Anansi, attempt to prove the truth of a proverb by showing what happens when one does not heed its inherent wisdom. One thing that people, too easily seduced by the city's charm and history and beauty, forget about Accra is that it is a major metropolis. Accra is New York. It is Los Angeles. It is Shanghai, Mexico City, Santiago, Caracas, and Cape Town. It is an urban area with poverty, desperation, and the inevitable result of a marriage between the two, crime. In his book, The Coming Anarchy, Shattering the Dreams of the Post-Cold War, Robert D. Kaplan, an expert on global affairs, writes, "Crime is what makes West Africa a natural point of departure for my report on what the political character of our planet is likely to be in the 21st century. The cities of West Africa at night are some of the unsafest places in the world. Streets are unlit. The police often lack gasoline for their vehicles. Armed burglars, carjackers, and muggers proliferate." The stories that you will read in this collection will highlight all things Accra, everything that the city was and is, the remaining vestiges of colonialism, the pride of independence, the nexus of indigenous tribes and other groups from all over the world, the tension between modernity and traditionalism, the symbolism and storytelling, both obvious and coded, the moral high ground, the duplicity and deceit, the most basic human failings laid bare alongside fear and love and pain, and the corrupting desire to have the very things you are not meant to have. Much like Accra, these stories are not always what they seem. The contributors who penned them know too well how to spin a story into a web, elaborate with a geometrical arrangement of lines and a beautiful network of fractals. Read them carefully. Read between those lines. Consider the context. Beware of a pretext. Search for a subtext. Remember that in the culture that defines this city, everything holds meaning and is sending a message. Kweku Anansi exists in each story in different forms. It is an honor and a pleasure to share these stories. Classic Anansi-sem, spider stories, in the guise of noir fiction, and all they reveal about Accra, a city of allegories, one of the most dynamic and diverse places in the world. Nanama Danquah, Accra, Ghana, September 2020. Part 1. One Day for Master. Chop Money. Nana Ekuya Brew Hammond. Malam Atta Market.
Lima abruptly lifted her head from the sticky valley of Charles' chest, stretching to light the wick. My time up already. Lima ignored him, hurriedly reaching for her t-shirt and skirt. Self-consciously, she checked that her hair tie was still in place before bending to hand him his uniform and boots. The flame made shadow ghouls of the rubber soles. Do you think I will steal your shoes from your feet? She half-teased, noting his name crudely etched on the inner tongues. Charles thought everyone was out to take something from him. She handed him the boots now, kneading him out so she could return the stall to her friend Asana. I know you have to go back, and I have to clean this place. He wore his rifle like a handbag before retrieving a 5-cedi bill. He held the flaccid note over her head.
You said she's raised the price.
From 30 to 50,000.
The Bank of Ghana had moved the decimal point 4 places over 10 years ago because carrying fistfuls of cash, sometimes sacks, in the tens of thousands for groceries or taxi fare had become unwieldy and dangerous.
But for Lima and everyone else who worked in the market, the currency redenomination might as well have never happened. It hadn't changed the cedi's value or stemmed inflation.
Nothing free in Ghana, Charles said,
almost wistful, as he handed her the limp legal tender. No, nothing. Lima loosened the padlock at the door. But still, Charles lingered.
I worry about you here alone.
He adjusted his beret, the 2 chevron stripes on his navy shirt's shoulder band, indicating he was a corporal, were luring yellow in the wick's light. Didn't you all catch the rapist?
Is there only one? He shrugged. You may see me tomorrow night. Munshre is recording a program here with that comedian, Ahmed Razak. The MP has requested extra police presence.
She thought of whom she could leave Adama with so she can make more money with Charles. Asana usually watched her son, but tonight her friend wasn't able to. Adama was with Lima's fellow Kayaye in the storage sheds outside the market. But Lima didn't like this arrangement. The Kayaye were watching the owner's goods they would pile onto their heads and sell at the market during the day, and watching for armed robbers and rapists with the same eyes that monitored her son. But if she kept making an extra 50,000 a week, 40 after she paid Asana, she could start renting her own store. The thought softened the edges of her impatience.
The Monsieur people were here all day giving out flyers for a competition, she said. They say the prize is a car and a date with Ahmed Razak.
Charles punched diagonal lines into the air and twisted the toe of his boot like he was extinguishing a cigarette, mimicking the horizontal dance Razak opened his variety show with. His rifle swayed with the movement.
I hope you're not entering the contest when you have your own Ahmed Razak right here.
She laughed at his poor attempt at horizontal, ushering him out.
They want only fat girls to enter. The show is called Am I Your Size?
Heavyweights make the best champions.
It was only Charles' height that made his massive punch describable as a boxer's build.
Let me hear the lock.
Lima closed the door and the padlock's shackle, calculating how long it would take Charles to exit the market before she could return the stall key to Asana and get back to Adama. Lima and Asana had an arrangement. On the night she met Charles, Asana sublet Lima the store for 10,000 from 10 p.m. to 4 a.m.
But it was the eve of National Sanitation Day, and Auntie Mooney, Asana's landlord, would be in early to make a show of cleaning for the Accra Metropolitan Assembly inspectors.
They had agreed Lima should be out no later than 3 a.m. this time.
Lima quickly folded Asana's thin foam mattress and pushed it under Auntie Mooney's counter.
Then she gathered her pan and the stiff desk of folded cloth she used when carrying it, loading with customer purchases on her head. Again, she touched her head tie, feeling through the yellow polyester for the thinning spot in the middle of her pate, remembering how thick her hair had been before she came to Accra last year to Kaya. Checking for the knife she carried in her handbag, the one she had started sleeping with when Joy FM reported that a rapist was targeting Kayeye, she unlocked the store again. Briskly, she stepped out, her senses sharpened to any presence of sound beyond the ambient snarling of dogs in combat and scampering rats. Lima had walked the length of Malama Atta Market so many times in the last year, she could do it in her sleep. Daily, she shadowed aging madams huffing in the heat and spry young ones who seemed to stop short at every store, almost capsizing her pan. Often, she carried for house help dispatched by their madams, some auditioning for a bigger role with insults they believed their bosses would hurl, most drifting too slowly through the rush, shove, and sidestep of the market, glad to be working remotely. Occasionally, tourists looking for places to stage their vacation selfies gave her a gratuity for carting their personal items on her head. Foreigners tipped the best. Once, one had pressed a 10-CD note into her hand. 100,000! She was lucky to get more than 2,000 from anyone else. With about 10 customers a day, she averaged 70 to 100,000 a week, most of it going to food, phone credit, and her family back home. Since she had been seeing Charles consistently these past 4 months, Lima had been able to count on an extra 20,000, now 40,000. As she turned the corner, the Odomi Street exit in sight, Lima remembered she had forgotten to blow out the wick. She sucked her teeth and turned back, doubling her pace. When she reached the corner store, a hand snaked out.
"You don't rent this stall."
When Lima realized it was Charles who had ambushed her, she had already sunk all but the hilt of her knife into the flesh under his chevrons. With his strong arm, he yanked her by a headscarf. Lima felt the scallop edge polyester slip past her shoulders as her heart made an uneven rhythm of her breath.
"I saw you last week and the week before. You switched places with the one who rents it."
Watching Charles pulled the knife out of his arm with a pained gurgle, she felt exhausted by her lie. In the beginning, she had hoped their relationship could progress beyond these market nights, but now she realized she had just been deceiving herself. Blood spurted from his bicep, surprising them both.
"I want the money I've been giving you these last 4 months. Every peswa."
Quickly, she inserted the key and yanked the padlock open, pulling him inside. The flame gyrated with the oxygen the open door brought in. Lima went for the dettol behind the counter. The bottle held just a splash. She dragged down one of the many pieces of lace packed on the shelf that lined the wall,
tore it free from its plastic casing, and soaked a corner of it with the antiseptic.
The chemical stench filled the store. Charles whimpered as he struggled to unbutton his shirt. His right sleeve was now dripping rivulets of blood. Lima handed him the dettol-soaked lace with shaking hands and watched him hurl it across the store. The wick flickered dangerously.
"I have to go to hospital,"
he said with the weary sobriety of a child forced to admit misbehavior. His blood was everywhere, all over his hands, on his trousers, fat drops on his boots, smears on Lima's t-shirt and the scarf that had been on her head. The cracked tile floor, a poor man's mosaic, was slippery with it.
"Help me up," Charles barked.
Lima was a petite girl, slim and slight. The flame watched her futile attempts to hoist him.
"Help me help you up,"
she ordered finally, both of them alarmed when he couldn't. Then he slumped, his weight pinning her to the ground. She wriggled out from under him, her foot knocking the wick in the process. She gasped at the sudden blackness and the silence that followed. only her breath and heartbeat in her ears.
Lima,
Asana whispered sharply.
Ah, Lima knew she had to be out before Auntie Mooney came.
She tapped the metal door insistently, pulling at her phone. The number you have dialed has been switched off, reported the British woman who had won the contract to voice all such messages. Please try again later. It was almost 4 a.m.
In an hour, Auntie Mooney will be at the market or close.
Lima!
Banging now, Asana wondered with mounting anxiety whether her friend had forgotten to drop off the key before heading to collect her son. She only had one and had given it to Lima. Asana sank to the cement incline that rose into the store. Seething, she rehearsed the curses she would hurl at Lima
and the cluelessness she would perform if Auntie Mooney came to meet her locked out. She rented the store from Auntie Mooney for $30,000 a week.
She only had use of it at night, to sleep in when the market closed. As part of their rental agreement, Asana cleaned the store before she left in the morning, had her bath at the market shower,
and then returned to sell special ice water for Auntie Mooney,
getting 5 pesos for every 30 peso sachet she sold, on top of the 2,500 a day Aunt Mooney paid her. The arrangement was a luxury Asana worked hard to keep, so she wouldn't have to return to sleeping outside, praying away rain, armed robbers, and rapists. The 10,000 she took from Lima each week enabled her to save some of the roughly 200,000
20 CDs in the new money she earned weekly, selling for Auntie Mooney.
She planned to buy her own special ice carton and bring her junior sister from their uncle's farm in Yendi to sell for her until she could one day own a market store.
But every week, Lima did something to risk Auntie Mooney finding out that Asana let her use the stall to sleep with her police officer.
She always seemed to forget something. A scarf, a still-smoking mosquito coil, a condom wrapper.
And she always left later than they agreed upon 4 a.m., giving Asana little time to clean up after her.
This week, she had not only told Lima to leave at 3, but made an excuse not to watch Adama, hoping Lima would finish early to pick him up. Asana regretted this now, realizing she had no guarantee Lima would come straight back to her. Ready to pound the metal door again, she heard a rustle coming from inside. Her pocket vibrated. She hissed Lima's name into her phone.
Open for me!
Asana listened for the metallic slide of the unlocking door and pushed her way in. Her eyes adjusting to the darkness, she turned toward the sound of two distinct ragged breaths, suddenly afraid she had entered a trap.
Lima? Gombeni?
She asked in their native Dagmani, hoping the rapist or armed robber who might be holding her friend hostage couldn't understand.
I am fine. Lima's voice shook.
Why are you in the dark? Asana's eyes still adjusting. She moved toward Lima's voice and tripped. Scrimmaging to her elbows, Asana turned to see what had made her fall. It hadn't been Lima's selling pan or some other discarded object. Whatever it was had the mass of an animal. A big one. Like one of the cows the men in Yendi used to pool money to buy and kill for Eid. She pulled herself up, yanking her phone from her pocket.
Charles.
Lima explained as Asana directed the device's light to the body.
Asana gasped.
There was a lifeless police officer in Auntie Mooney's store, and there was blood.
She put her hands on her head.
I thought he was an attacker.
Asana nodded, understanding. There wasn't a female among them who didn't know the fear that came with night. Whether guarding the wares they sold in the storage sheds or asleep on the roadside just outside Malata, they lived with the paranoia of attacks past and recent. Even those who could pay to sleep in padlocked market stores were vulnerable to armed robbers and rapists who knew they might be inside, easily overpowered.
We have to get him out of here before Auntie Mooney comes.
He's too heavy.
Lima's voice was thin with despair.
We should call the police.
And tell them what? You thought your married officer was an attacker, so you killed him?
Asana turned her phone's light on Lima. Her friend sat defeated. The swatch of fabric she had earlier worn wrapped around her hair now draped around her shoulders and streaked with blood. The golden circle of scalp she was so self-conscious about, exposed.
A police officer is dead. It will be your word, Akayayo, against his family's desire to bury him honorably, his wife's embarrassment, and his fellow officer's fear of crackdown when it's discovered he was with you instead of at his checkpoint. No, we have to remove him and clean this place before the market opens.
More afraid of what Auntie Mooney might do to her than the police.
Asana turned her phone around, the light searing her eyes. 3:57 a.m. The market opened at 6, but proprietors would start arriving by 5.
The AMA inspectors will be here,
she reminded Lima. The Accra Metropolitan Assembly often dispatched officials for surprise sanitation checks, but it being National Sanitation Day, they would be in the market in numbers.
And not telling when the Munshre people will start coming. We have to do it now.
We could take him to the hospital.
Do you have 150,000 for a taxi to Kolebu?
Asana sucked her teeth.
He's already dead. Start cleaning up. I'm going to find out some help to clear the body.
Mooney accidentally kicked a short stack of plastic buckets as she turned the corner on the path to her store.
Who left these here?
She asked the small girl sweeping in front of the first shop in the row. Even though it wasn't her store, the AMA inspectors would use such infractions to threaten to fine the owner, a pretext for negotiating lesser levies that would bypass the city's coffers for their own pockets. Where the inspectors started, they would linger.
Clear them now.
Yes, Auntie Mooney.
In front of her store, Mooney parted her bag's leather band and gold link handles to rummage for her keys. She dug past her phone, her face powder compact, blotting papers, a handkerchief, a Munshre TV flyer, PK chewing gum wrappers, and magazine perfume strips she collected, always on the hunt for a new scent. Finally, she found her wallet, pulling out the keys that dangled from the ring attached to the zipper. Mooney tugged at the padlock and latched the heavy spinach green metal door to the loop that moored it to the cement wall. She sniffed compulsively, as she did every morning. To her surprise, her shop smelled good. Fresh even. Her kayayo and tenant, Asana, did a good job cleaning the store. But there was a smell about the girl that always lingered. None of Mooney's customers had yet complained about an unpleasant musk, and most of her lace was sheathed in plastic. But she worried nonetheless that the girl's raw odor would pique a sensitive nose like hers or seep into her stock. This morning, though, the place had a lemony antiseptic smell to it. The shelves looked neater, too.
Thank you, my dear.
Outdid yourself. The shop is looking great.
She texted Asana, using the shorthand her son, Abdul, messaged her with. Abdul and his sister would be coming soon to help her man the shop. She had seen on the Munshre TV flyer that the area MP and his wife, Alice, were planning to welcome Ahmed Razak to the market. Alice had become something of a friend during her husband's campaign, meeting regularly with the market shopkeepers to rally their support. Even after his win, Alice always dropped by Mooney's store and picked up a few yards of lace when she was at Malata. Mooney looked forward to showing her the new pieces that had come in. Abdul and Mariama were supposed to be at the market by 7 a.m., but Asana and the other girls were to report before 6 to account for yesterday's sales and refill their pans with the supplies they'd be selling. She unlocked the store's back door, which led to her small storeroom and the deep freezer inside. She switched on the generator. The power supply had been out for 2 straight half days,
but the cakes of frosty ice in the freezer had kept the water cold enough. The same couldn't be said for the ice cream and frozen yogurt. She felt the plastic sachets of fan ice and fan yogurt mixed in with the small water packets and frowned at their mushiness. As Mooney walked away, she noticed a plastic soap bottle on the floor. Instead of the syrupy green fairy liquid the label advertised, there was a watery yellow solution inside. It was too pale to be urine, she decided, tentatively raising it to her nose. The pungent odor of ammonia and lemons induced her gag reflex. This was the scent that had greeted her when she opened her stall. She recognized it now as the cleaning fluid the market butchers used to disinfect meat, and the oddly pleasing fragrance that clung to Ibrahim. She arched her eyeliner, traced eyebrows, and blinked away tears as she jumped to conclusions. Of course Ibrahim would want to be with someone his own age, she told herself. Aside from the way she smelled, Asana was a pretty girl.
Auntie Mooney?
The little girl who had been sweeping interrupted her thoughts.
Yes, my dear.
She put the bottle down, covering her hurt with a smile.
I have removed the buckets.
But what if it was Mr. Selifu? Mooney asked herself, blooming with hope that Asana's visitor had been Ibrahim's boss instead. Resolving to ask Asana point blank if she had broken the agreement by bringing a man into her store, Mooney dug in her bag and gave the girl the 5 peso coin she was angling for. She followed the child out to see if Asana or any of her other kayayes were coming. The market would be open in 20 minutes. Morning light was diluting the sky, and now, as far down the row as Mooney could see, small girls were sweeping. The sound of the dried reed brooms swiping rock-studded earth and cement was almost orchestral, accompanied by the creaks of traders dragging wood tables and benches into arrangement and shopkeepers freeing heavy metal doors from their locks. The shrill of a loudspeaker suddenly disrupted this market symphony, a prelude to the more guttural beats of transaction that would come when the shops opened.
Testing,
a man's voice announced, his breath heavy in the distant microphone.
Monstre TV test.
Mooney pulled a handbag open to retrieve the Monstre flyer. A sinewy young man with a dimpled grin had pressed it into her hand yesterday, on her way to the 50 peswa toilets.
There's still time to enter, madame,
he had said. She looked up at him, noting his Monstre TV t-shirt.
Am I your size?
She flirted, reading the title of the show.
Fatulous,
he answered. Mooney had giggled at his unblinking recitation of Ahmed Razik's catchphrase.
You should enter and try for the car.
She winked at him.
I have cars already.
The Monstre boy had reminded her of Ibrahim, rangy and brimming with the muscular energy of youth. Now, she tucked the flyer back in her bag, feeling fresh pain at the prospect of her lover having been in her store with Asana.
My guy never show.
Ken shook his head at his supervisor.
Those Malata girls have Charles under a spell.
What kind of joke go for 4 hours?
Sergeant Dua joked about Charles' longer than usual absence. The two men were moving the pair of metal barricades that made up their checkpoint on the neighborhood border between Tesno and Abeka. They leaned them against a tree off the road along with the plastic chairs they, really, Ken, had been keeping watch in all night. Ken suppressed a growl. He didn't care what kind of sex Charles was having, or why he was traveling 20 minutes by road to have it when there were girls much closer to home. He was sick of doing Charles's job, and Sergeant Duas too. Both men exploited Ken's freshman rank, one of them usually disappearing for hours from whatever checkpoint they were assigned, or cutting him out of whatever something small they coaxed from midnight drivers. How he longed to report them. But he knew retaliation would be swift. the old guard viewed any attempt at reform by younger officers as a breach of discipline. There were 44 breaches listed in the Ghana Police Service Handbook, but only two were consistently punished. The first, disobedience of a lawful order given him by his senior in rank, whether verbally or in writing, or by authorized signal on parade. The second, communicating to any unauthorized person matters connected with the service without permission from the senior police officer under whom he serves. Ken was not so naive that he hadn't expected some form of hazing on the job. His uncle, now a chief inspector, had prepared him with tales of his first year constable days. But even if he hadn't, Ken knew his people. Ghanaians acquired power three ways: money, position, and age. And when they had it, they wielded it with a hammer's blunt force. Fitting his helmet over his head, he seated himself behind Dua on the senior officer's motorcycle. Taking advantage of the relatively open pre-rush hour in Sawam Road, Dua sipped to their moon shred assignment at Malata Market. When they arrived, Dua stayed on the bike.
"I'm coming, eh?"
With gritted teeth, Ken watched Dua rev away, reminding himself that when the new class of academy graduates entered, he would move up a rung. He had received high commendations from his senior officers, and his uncle was friendly with the Inspector General of Police. He had hoped that he would be considered for early promotion. Advancing from constable to lance corporal would mean a little more power and little less abuse. He yawned, wiping away a tear of exhaustion as he strode past the sign announcing Malamata Market. Located in Kokomlemle, the central Accra neighborhood built in the early 1950s to accommodate the city's population spike, Malata served 1,800 customers daily, including workers in the now mostly commercial district and residents in neighboring Newtown. From fresh vegetables to hair braiding services, one could find almost anything among the stalls and stands spread across the market's 57,499 square yards. Stepping over a slim gutter, Ken braced himself as he passed through the entry partition between Malata's cement walls. When Ken was a child, his mother sold cloth in Kumasi's Kechete Market. Growing up, he had felt claustrophobic in the stadium-sized Crush Laurel as West Africa's largest open-air bazaar. His childhood had been populated by men wielding crates and sacks filled with everything from water sachets to grand millet, and women stationed behind tables topped with pyramids of tomatoes, student math sets, or pans brimming with all manner of powdered condiments, all incessantly haggling. When he reached his teens, and his mother made him roam the market for customers, balancing folded fabric stacks on his head, his aversion to market hustle hardened. He couldn't remember a happier day than when his uncle offered to pay his way through the police academy. Now, as he followed the traffic ambling toward the blaring Munshire TV speakers, he resented his first year rank all the more. Malata attacked with a slew of sensory assaults. While the morning sun overexposed Vodafone red and MTN yellow umbrellas, massive wooden sheds roofed with corrugated iron sheets made shadowy figures of those transacting inside. Between the sheds and umbrellas, the narrow paths were choked. Suppliers squeezed through carton boxes or plastic containers. Preachers outfitted with microphones and portable speakers admonished anyone within earshot. Itinerant chickens avoided children free from their caretakers' backs who were chasing each other in dusty circles, urinating or shitting within spitting distance of guardians skinning oranges or hacking sugar cane stalks. Patrons punctuated the chaos, rushing, dawdling, picking, poking, bargaining. Threading through it all, the kayaye. The mostly teenage kaya girls either balanced on their heads metal china pans coated in chipping plastic, waited with the purchases of patrons they were mauling for, or scanned for customers with pouncing eyes.
Some worked with babies, strapped to their backs with faded cloth. Ken noticed AMA inspectors chatting some kayaya up, grazing them, patting them, blocking their paths. Maneuvering through the walkways like the reluctant market boy he once was, Ken found the munshra setup with relative ease. Four rows of pink plastic chairs faced a wooden stage, and the clipboard wielding women on it was directing a camera crew into position. Ken moved behind the platform, hoping to find a supervisor to note his punctuality. He quickened his gait when he saw Inspector Kwaraku. The senior officer was engaged in what looked like a serious discussion with another uniform. Ken slowed his steps, surprised to see Duo with him, holding a pair of boots.
"I found someone on the roadside trying to sell them," Duo said.
He placed the boots on a table and peeled back one tongue, revealing Charles's name.
"Maybe he gave them to the seller," Ken said.
"Charles is too big for someone to steal them off his feet." He turned to Inspector Kwaraku to see if he agreed.
"Look at them," Dua said.
Then Ken saw the blood.
Returning to her stall, after a brief walk down the row, Muni dabbled her trickling hairline. A musky odor was aloft, and she knew Asana was now in the tight confines of the storeroom. She used her munshra flyer to wave away the smell, then dipped her nose in her handbag, inhaling the mingled notes of used perfumed strips.
"You've been using the deodorant I gave you?"
Asana looked up from the pan. She was hardly filling with water sachets.
"Yes, Auntie Muni."
"Then why your foul smell?"
Muni didn't ask because she wanted to know instead if Asana had entertained Ibrahim in her store. With impatience, she squinted at her employee and tenant.
"Your pan will be too heavy."
The girl, still packing on her knees, looked up again.
"Sorry?"
"Asana, did you have someone in my shop overnight?"
Muni watched Asana spread her arms, fasten each hand on either side of the pan, and raise it to her head in one motion.
"Never, Auntie Muni," she said, almost too coolly. "Please, can I go?"
I saw that the munshra people brought bottled water for the crowd, but the sun is growing hot. People will need more.
"You clean this place very well, Asana. You use a different soap. Where did you get it?"
"Mr. Salifu."
"The butcher? Or one of his assistants?"
"I knew the AMA people would be here this morning, so I couldn't just sweep. I had to scrub. But the dettol was finished. I'm always seeing Mr. Salifu's boy scrubbing, so I asked him for some cleaning solution."
"Which boy?"
Asana's eyes bored into Mooney's.
"Jonathan."
Muni watched her kaya girl stagger slightly under the weight of the pan as she reached for the bottle.
"I'll take it back to him."
"You go and sell. I will return it to Mr. Selifu."
Asana stepped out of the store into the bright, hot chaos before turning her head gingerly to face her landlady.
"Oh, Auntie Muni, I have to go home for a few days. Someone has died."
Muni hated to lose Asana even for a short while.
"Maybe your friend could step in while you're gone."
"I'll ask."
As Asana retreated, Muni's phone lit up with her son's picture.
"Abdul, where are you?"
Background noise answered.
"Did I tell you and your sister to come here for the Munshra TV? Come at once!"
She would go to Ibrahim when the children relieved her. She resumed fanning herself as a woman walked into her shop.
"Hello, madame."
Muni sang the greeting, hawking the customer's hesitation at a diamante-studded bolt of teal and fuchsia fabric cut into connected leaves.
"Swiss lace, authentic."
When the woman walked out, Muni took out her phone and opened WhatsApp.
"Where are you?"
She shook the soap bottle impatiently until her son and daughter startled her. Muni immediately left the kids to watch the shop, bounding outside.
Her hairline sprouted more sweat with the exertion,
the trickles streaking her foundation, beading under her chin. She mopped the drops, stopping absently to finger a pack of plastic-wrapped yaki weave dangling from the hair braiding stall she passed. Her profuse sweating cost her so much in hair and blotting papers, she lamented as she walked on, fluffing her synthetic curls. She took the long way to Mr. Selifu's, asking herself why she was so shaken by the prospect of Asana lying that Ibrahim, not Jonathan, had given her the cleaning solution, and perhaps something more. If Ibrahim had done something with Asana, he was free to. Muni was a married woman with children close to his age. And if he hadn't done anything with Asana, her heart beat with hope. Then it was just as Asana had said. When she reached the butcher's, Muni's eyes immediately sought Ibrahim. Mr. Selifu, she projected for Ibrahim's benefit.
Auntie Muni.
The old man looked up from the warped wooden table he was carefully slicing goat flesh on. Ibrahim and Jonathan stood at opposite sides of the table behind him. It seemed impossible to Muni that Ibrahim was the same age as his fellow apprentice. At 17, Jonathan looked like a child playing doctor.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.